Well, money is how we keep score in this game. Horses compete for purse money, which is paid for first, second, third, and fourth place finishes, and at some tracks, horses are paid for fifth place finishes. And with the first $1 million purse in thoroughbred history on schedule for next summer, the figures for purse money are threatening to go off the scoreboard. Let's look now at the money-winning earner of all times. Of course, he was our last year's Horse of the Year spectacular bid. He retired to stud with earnings of $2,781,607. He made 30 starts in three seasons, won 26 races, and was syndicated for $22 million. Now, these figures are a sign of his talent, but also a sign of the inflated times. Of the top 12 money earners in history, the top two have raced recently, and that shows you that they've had the edge in these inflationary days of purse money. Let's look at the top 12. Spectacular Bid, of course, heads up the list. He is number one, just shy of $3 million. Affirmed, who had previously led the list with earnings of over $2 million, he is second. Look at Kelso. He is in third place. Now, he was a gelding. He made 63 starts in an abnormally long racing career, and he was the leader until he was displaced. Now, he earned nearly $2 million racing till he was a nine-year-old back in the early 60s, when the dollar was still a little bit sound as Kelso anyway. Number 10 on the list is Secretariat. He raced but two seasons, was retired as a three-year-old, made 21 starts, and he earned that money in the early 70s. And there they are, the top 12 earners of history. Now, we all know that the dollar certainly is not what it used to be, not hardly. So the people over at the Blood Horse magazine thought it would be interesting to see how the money earners of today compared with the money earners of yesteryear, and they converted this earnings list according to inflation by the Consumer Price Index, and it is very interesting what happens to the horses who race today as compared to the great horses of days gone by. We get a little bit truer look at what they actually earned back in the old days. So for sake of comparison, let's look one more time at the present list. These are the top 12 earners as they stand on today's dollars. Watch what happens when these dollars are inflation adjusted. Look who goes to the head of the list, old durable Kelso. He was number three before in regular dollars, but his previous record of having led the list still stands up in inflation-converted dollars, over $5 million on this conversion table. Spectacular Bid, who had been the previous leader, drops all the way down to number 11. And look who makes an appearance on the list, who we did not see on the previous list, Whirlaway. He was the first horse ever to earn over $500,000 way back in the early 40s, and what an accomplishment that was in those days. On the standard list, you find him nowhere, but on the converted inflation list, he ranks number 9 with earnings in excess of $3 million. Secretariat, who had been 10th on the standard list, dropped all the way down to 23rd. We don't even see him anymore. So while your dollar doesn't go very far in the grocery store these days, believe me, it doesn't go very far buying horse feed. These big figures are glamorous, but they don't buy any more in the horse business than they do in civilian life.
Lucky My Way on the extreme outside with T. Sipper. Along the inside, Lean with Concilia and Markham Lousy. T. Sipper has the early lead by a length and a half. Lean on the rail, second by a half. Markham Lousy on the outside, third by about a length. Then Afternoon Delight, Lucky My Way, Concilia, followed by Love and Lass. On the outside again is Contrary Rose, and Andrea F. is ninth. The first quarter of Fast 22. Into the far turn, T-Sipper still leads by a length and a half. Lean in second by two. Afternoon Delight is third and gaining ground. Markham Lousy on the rail, fourth by a neck. Then Lucky My Way, Concilia, Contrary Rose, all heads apart. At the top of the stretch now, T-Sipper on the rail has the lead by two. Lean in second by two. Then Afternoon Delight, Concilia, Markham Lousy, and Contrary Rose. Approaching the eighth pole now. The half is fast, 45. T-Sipper on the rail still leads by two. Lean still in second by a length. Contrary Rose gains on the outside, challenging for second, but to the wire, that's T-Sipper in front.
Well, in our series of famous old horses, my pleasure to introduce you to Whirlaway, who first appeared on the scene as a two-year-old in 1940. He was bred and belonged to Calumet Farm. He won 7 out of 16 as a two-year-old, and I think the two exciting things about him were his style and his appearance. He was a stretch runner, and American racing fans seemed to love that, and he had an exciting appearance. He was small, bright red, a chestnut, and he had a long, flowing tail. And one of the reasons that tail was so long is because his famous trainer, Ben Jones, was a very opinionated, talented man. And one of his opinions was that you should not comb a tail. A tail was to swat flies and balance horses. And this tail comb, if it was found in the hands of a groom, he was usually unemployed pretty quick. And because of that tail, Whirlaway picked up the name Mr. Longtail. Well, the Derby is then, and it is now, everybody's dream. And so when he went into his three-year-old year, Whirlaway was pointed for it, but he had problems. He kept bearing out through all of his races as a two-year-old and in his early three-year-old year, and it was because of his leads. He took a turn on his right lead when you should come out of it as his left lead. To show you what I mean, I'm going to give you an example of a horse coming out of a turn on his left lead as he should, not the wrong way that Whirlaway did it on his right side.
Watch now, his left foreleg will appear always the more prominent. You see the left leg the furthest forward, and watch the sequence of them hitting the ground. The left leg forward now hits right hind, then left hind, then right fore. Left fore, right hind, left hind, and right fore. That's the sequence of the legs hitting the ground. The suspension is as he propels himself in the air right now. Then right, and left. Now, almost as though for our own video, the rider hits him with his stick right-handed, and watch the flying lead change. You see the horse accommodate himself, change the situation, and now the right foreleg becomes the prominent leg. Now it's right, left hind, and left fore. And always the right leg the more prominent in the beat.
Well, that's the way to do it when you're in the stretch. Whirlaway wanted to do it coming around the turn. And getting ready for the Derby, it became a problem. Well, Ben Jones, famous for so many things, winning among them, was an equipment man. An extension blinker, which you see a great deal now, is no doubt invented for this horse by Ben Jones. No cup on the inside eye, this extension blinker on the right eye. The attitude being, if you direct the vision, there will go the horse. And it certainly was a good factor in Whirlaway's success. But before the Derby, there was another factor, a rider change. For the first time, Eddie R. Carroll, who was under contract to the Green Tree Stable and not always available, became available, and Ben Jones put him on Whirlaway. Now, R. Carroll was a brilliant rider for many, many years. All of you know his records and his talents, but among all things, he was considered a strong rider. And one of the ways to keep a horse from bearing out is obviously to have a strong rider aboard. So when Derby Day came May 7th in 1941, Whirlaway was ready with his new blinker and his new rider, and let's go to Louisville and see how that Derby was run.
Whirlaway. 1. Robert Morris is 5th, and Whirl Away is far back. Midway of the backstretch, it's still Dispose on the front end and by 2 lengths. Blue Pear is 2nd, Waters Cap is 3rd, a gap of 5 lengths, Steritar is 4th, Our Boots is 5th, and here comes Whirl Away moving up on the rail. By a length and a half. Blue Pear is 3rd, and here comes Whirl Away, number 4. Into the stretch, it's Whirl Away in front by 3 and drawing away. Steritar is 2nd, Porter's Cap is 3rd, and Market Wise. It's Whirl Away drawing clear. It's Whirl Away, an easy winner.
Well, he was an easy winner, a new track and stake record, 201 and 2, that stood until 1962. And if you notice, with Ben Jones' new equipment and Eddie R. Carroll on him, he went up along the inside on the backstretch, something he had never done, and was very manageable down through the stretch. With the same rider and the same equipment, he went on to win the Preakness and the Belmont and become a Triple Crown winner. This is, of course, a great accomplishment. And he won the next 2 steps of the Triple Crown with just the same kind of ease. Now it became obvious that we had an exciting horse. His stretch running tactics had all America up in devotion to him. He wound up the year winning 13 out of 20, was the horse of the year, the 3-year-old of the year. And everybody knew they had a big boy and a hero in town and were anxiously awaiting his next year's competition. Well, Whirl Away was a good shipper. And as Ben Jones went west in November of 41 with a carload of horses on a train, but when he got to California, Pearl Harbor arrived. Racing was canceled on the west coast, and the little brilliant-looking horse didn't get going again until in the east the next spring. This is the spring of 42, and he won the Dixie and the Trenton and the Massachusetts, was mowing them down, and he was the champ, but always there's somebody comes along. It was a 3-year-old. A lowly beginning horse bought for $700 as a yearling, a horse named Al Sab, and he'd won the Preakness, beaten the nose in the Belmont. He ran every week, and he ran good. And again, as it did in those times, as it did in War Admiral Seabiscuit, the hue and the cry for a match race. And it was brought about, this match race, a weight for age, 26 on Whirl Away, 19 on Al Sab. It was run in New England at Narragansett, was very popular, now defunct track, near Providence, Rhode Island, and Carol Bierman rode Al Sab, Georgie Wolf, on our little horse Whirl Away. Let's take a look at this race run in Providence in 1942.
In the backstretch, Al Sab is leading by 3 lengths and is under a stout hold. As they approach the far turn, Whirl Away is starting to move up on the outside. Around the turn, Al Sab still holds a length. But Whirl Away is coming on. As they turn into the stretch, it's still Al Sab in front. And here comes Whirl Away under the whip. It's Al Sab by 3/4 of a length. Al Sab by a half. With Whirl Away still coming on. It's Al Sab by a half a length. And here's the winner. It's Al Sab by a nose.
Still, they hadn't seemed to learn what our Carol finally proved to the world. If you're going to run in a match race, you let nobody take the lead by himself. Bierman on Al Sab stole away. Whirl Away missed catching him by a nose. However, later in that year, he did win the Jockey Club and turn the tables on little Al Sab. Whirl Away ran twice unsuccessfully as a 5-year-old, wound up with a record of 32 wins out of 60 starts, first horse over a half a million, was retired to stud, and was sort of a failure. He was shipped to France to stand in stud there, died an untimely death in 1953 and didn't leave many successful horses in his stead, but he was a marvelous horse. He proved what a colorful equine athlete can do, appealing to the American public. I enjoyed talking to you about Whirl Away.
far turn, Jigs Alarm and Accuray, they battle noses apart for the lead. Quick rotation to length third, Lindlore moves on the outside is fourth. Length and a half, Camp Robber on the extreme outside fifth, Flippig is sixth. Lord Avey on the outside seventh, along with Pleasant Colony. Now as they move toward the top of the stretch, Accuray, Jigs Alarm, their noses apart for the lead. Lindlore now moving between horses, and here comes Lord Avey on the outside with a bold move. It's Lord Avey coming on after the leaders. Accuray has the lead. Lord Avey closing on the outside. Pleasant Colony moving on the rail. It's Lord Avey. Three horses across the track. Pleasant Colony in between horses. Accuray.
Bell Bay on the rail, on the outside, Stiff Sentence, huge success, Irish Tower and Charlie Coast, those four five across the track. Irish Tower, the high weight, now takes the lead by a neck. Charlie Coast on the outside, second by a half, then Stiff Sentence, huge success, heads apart, third and fourth. Five back, it's Bell Bay, the next frontier, and Pete Moss. Approaching the clubhouse turn now. Leading the way, it's Irish Tower by two, then Charlie Coast is second by a half, and Stiff Sentence on the rail is third, dropping back a bit. Four lengths further back to huge success. Then five again to Bell Bay, next frontier, and Pete Moss. On the back stretch, the first quarter, 23 and one. Irish Tower has the lead still by two and a half. Charlie Coast is second by three. Stiff Sentence in third by five. Huge success in fourth by three. Bell Bay in fifth by a length and a half. Then next frontier and Pete Moss still in seventh down the back stretch. The half in 47 and 2. Irish Tower, the high weight, still has the lead by a length, but Charlie Coast is gaining gradually on the outside, second by two and a half. Stiff Sentence in third by eight lengths, then huge success, Bell Bay, next frontier, and Pete Moss. Around the far turn, three quarters, 1:12 and 1. Irish Tower continues to lead by two. Charlie Coast, second by about five. Then Stiff Sentence is followed by huge success and Bell Bay at the top of the stretch. Irish Tower continues to lead, extending that lead now to three and a half. Charlie Coast, second by about seven. Then Stiff Sentence, huge success. Huge success has now taken third. Approaching the 16th pole, that's Irish Tower, leading by about four. Then Charlie Coast and huge success. Irish Tower in front.
In jail, what it means in horseman's lingo. First, I'll have to explain claiming procedure to you, Joe. To claim a horse, you have to be a licensed owner. You have to have the money on deposit with the horseman's bookkeeper. You have to have started a horse at the current meeting. You then fill out a slip, or a claim slip, supplied by the association. 15 minutes before the race involved, you drop it in the claim box. If there are more than one person claiming for a horse, you shake in a Kelly pool bottle and you pick out the winner, and that's who gets the horse. Now, after you get the horse for 30 days, you have to raise him 25% in value to run him. That's the period that the horsemen use the term the horse is in jail. That's where they have to run him. Joe, a side thought. These horsemen put up a lot of money to claim horses, and they're pretty sharp pros. Maybe there's a tip in it for the average horse player, and the way you tell whether a horse was claimed or not, you look in your daily racing form. And where you see the amount of money, the value of the horse, if he was claimed, in the daily racing form figure, you see a small C right beside the mount he ran for, the mount he was claimed for. Watch for the successful claims, Joe. In order to encourage and give young riders a chance, there's a situation, a weight allowance situation set up. A rider and he's till he's ridden five winners is allowed 10 pounds. And he actually doesn't count for record until then. After he's ridden his fifth winner, for the next 30 winners, he gets 7 pounds. And should those 35 winners come within the first year, which they usually do, he gets the remainder of that year, the date from the fifth winner to the end of that year, with a 5-pound allowance. And the leading apprentice rider here is Richard Migliori. And here is the young man right here. And how old are you, Richard?
I'm 16, sir.
Well, that's quite an accomplishment for 16 years old. Where did you get your start? Where did you learn to ride in this part of the country?
Well, I started in Long Island at Bill George's Lakeview Farm. And I was there for 2 years, breaking yearlings and riding quarter horses and learning the foundation with thoroughbreds. And when I went as far with that as I could, he told me that I should head on to Belmont, where I then hooked up with Steve DeMauro. And Mr. DeMauro, I've been under his wing for about 2 years now. And he's taught me everything I could possibly learn from him as far as race riding and the training of thoroughbreds.
Well, he's an ex-rider, and those trainers have an advantage in developing riders, so I'm like Warren Pascuma and those fellows, and I think he's probably taught you a great deal.
Yes, sir, he has. He's taught me all the gate work as far as breaking from the gate and really learning to gallop a horse, not to just sit on him and get him around, but to be part of the horse.
That's great. Let's take a look at you. You had quite a day here last Thursday. You had a double. I want to show the fans your seat and you winning a race here at There You Are. I think that was the second race.
Yes, sir, it was. I was riding a filly for Mr. Sosa, and he just told me that she had some speed and use it if I could and watch her because she tries to bear out. And all the things worked out exactly how he said, and I wound up into the stretch on the lead, and she went on from there.
Well, you won another race that day. That's a fine accomplishment for a young apprentice rider. I congratulate you. I tell all the fans to continue to watch these young pros around. They're the riders of the future. Here's the second half of your double that day. It's fun to watch winners, isn't it, and ride them.
Yes, sir, it is. And this was coming off of my suspension, so it was even all the more rewarding for me.
Well, the best of luck to you. We're glad to have you here, son. Lots of good luck.
Thank you, Mr.
Take on the outside, Proctor between horses, and Bold Iron in on the rail moving up. Then we come back to Buck Point. There's a half a length to Trader Man. Now as they move to the upper turn on the outside, it's Manguin taking command. Bold Iron is second, 2.5 lengths. Proctor is third. A length to Buck Point, fourth. Foretake is fifth. Trader Man sixth. There's a gap of 3 lengths. Lobe Sang is seventh. A length and a half. Little Bonnie eighth. The Messenger is ninth. Proud Manor on the outside, 10th. Then we come back to Ivory Hunter as 11th, and Cynthian Gold. Now on past the stand for the first time. Manguin has the lead on the hedge by a length and a half. Bold Iyer is second, length and a half. Proctor third. Buck Point is right alongside fourth. There's a length and a half. Proctor fifth. Trader Man on the hedge is 6, 4 lengths. Lobe Sang seventh. Little Bonnie eighth. Cynthian Gold ninth. Proud Manor is 10th. The Messenger is 11th. And Ivory Hunter. Lay a move on the clubhouse turn. Manguin continues to hold the lead by a length and a half. Bold Iyer is second. Foretake sees on the hedge third. Buck Point right alongside on the outside fourth. Proctor a close up fifth. The Trader Man is sixth. Length and a half on the outside. Little Bonnie is seventh. Proud Manor on the extreme outside is eighth. Lobe Sang ninth. Ivory Hunter on the extreme outside, 10th. They're midway down the backstretch. Manguin has the lead as Foretake. Now moves up to challenge, noses apart. Buck Point a length on the outside is third. Length and a half, Proctor fourth. Bold Iyer is fifth. The Trader Man sixth. Little Bonnie begins to move between horses, seventh. Proud Manor eighth. Lobe Sang ninth. Gap at 2.5 lengths. Ivory Hunter is 10th. They move on the far turn. Foretake a length and a half. Little Bonnie, a strong horse, moving on the hedge. Buck Point beginning to move on the outside. These three heads apart across the track. Now as they come toward the top of the stretch,
It's Little Bunny on the outside coming on to get the lead. Four takes second. Buck Point between horses third. Lope Sang fourth. Into the stretch. It's Little Bunny moving away by 2.5 lengths. Four takes second. Lope Sang with a move on the hedges third. Buck Point fourth. Through the stretch, it's Little Bonnie opening up the lead and drawing away by 4 lengths. Lope Sang is second, the battle for third, Buck Point and Forte. Little Bonnie goes away to an easy 4.5 length victory. That's the way they flashed under the wire in the Pan American Turf Handicap. Now back down to Lou Boda.